My Scorsese needle drop video did pretty well, so I'm gonna do like a series. And this week we're looking at Quentin Tarantino.
Girl, you'll be a woman soon.
Tarantino's music references work for the same reason his film references work. They're deep, deep cuts, and they come from a place of real passion. He doesn't just use popular songs to score his films. He reuses scores from other films, usually composed by Ennio Morricone, and borrows the breathtaking operatic quality that Morricone's music brought to Sergio Leone's spaghetti westerns. For The Hateful Eight, Tarantino got Morricone himself to write an original score, for which he ended up winning an Oscar. But Tarantino's greatest musical legacy is his ability to underscore his scenes with the perfect track from his record collection. So here are the very best needle drops of Tarantino's career. Needle drop doesn't go any deeper than pairing a cool image with a cool song. But there's nothing wrong with that when the song and the image are this fucking cool.
Everybody be cool, this is a robbery!
Any of you fucking pricks move! And I'll execute every motherfucking last one of you!
Tarantino chose Dick Dale for the opening credits of Pulp Fiction because he deemed surf rock to be the rock and roll version of classic spaghetti western music, and felt that it would set the appropriate mood for his modern rock and roll urban spaghetti western. And boy was he right. I especially love the way the frame freezes right before the needle drop. You can almost feel the actual needle drop. In the opening credits of Jackie Brown, the visual of Jackie gliding through LAX teases a quiet, soulful movie like The Graduate, which it shamelessly borrows from. But the song, Bobby Womack's theme from Across 110th Street, a million miles away musically from The Sound of Silence, establishes the film's groovy, vibrant, blaxploitation-inspired style. The song is also used brilliantly as a bookend in the final scene, to much more bittersweet effect than the opening, as Jackie gets away with the money, but the love of her life stays behind.
I'm not saying what I did was alright. Trying to break out of the ghetto was a day-to-day fight.
Bill, it's your baby.
Tarantino was 4-for-4 with his song choices in the first four opening credits sequences of his career. Bang Bang My Baby Shot Me Down by Nancy Sinatra in Kill Bill's opening titles has a great lyrical parallel with the story. Beatrix Kiddo's baby literally shot her down. Her ex-lover Bill shot her in the head on her wedding day. Sinatra's lesser-known hit gets a high-octane action thriller off to a subversively somber start. During the opening credits, the tragedy of the bride being left for dead really sinks in to make Kill Bill a bit more contemplative than the average revenge thriller. The Steeler's wheel scene in Reservoir Dogs is what really established Tarantino's penchant for awesome soundtracks. This diegetic needle drop harks back to the disturbing Singing in the Rain sequence from A Clockwork Orange. In that it pairs a whimsical melody with horrific acts of torture. And it makes the torturer look even more psychotic as they sing and dance their way through a brutal assault. It's so hard to keep this smile from my face.
Hold still, yeah.
Tarantino made better use of David Bowie's Cat People theme than the movie it was written for. Paul Schrader just dumped it in the end credits of Cat People, but Tarantino uses Bowie's brooding guitar licks to empower Shoshana as she gets dressed for the premiere, applies makeup like war paint, and prepares to kill Adolf Hitler. Kill Bill's use of the Battles Without Honor and Humanity theme has been named by Tarantino himself as his favorite needle drop of his filmography. Not only does it pair perfectly with the badassness of O Ren and her crew walking into the House of Blue Leaves in slow motion, it's become truly iconic in pop culture. Playing this song over a slow motion walk has become the go-to way to make a bunch of characters look badass. The moment was parodied in everything from Team America to Shrek the Third. At the Jackrabbit Slim's dance contest in Pulp Fiction, Tarantino plays You Never Can Tell by Chuck Berry, a song about two teenagers who are madly in love and decide to get married. Although Jackrabbit Slim's is a 50s themed restaurant and You Never Can Tell is from the early 60s, it's still the perfect choice for this scene. It captures the romantic tension fizzling between Vincent and Mia, and the dance is like a physical expression of that tension.
Clem, you all right?
And the sky is gray. I went for a walk on a winter's day.
Jose Feliciano's sad, sobering cover of California Dreamin' plays over the Calm Before the Storm montage in Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, and it perfectly encapsulates the movie's bittersweet nostalgia for an era of the film industry and an era of American society that was about to end with a horrific, earth-shattering mass murder.
Yeah, but you can't get new stuff on records.
I don't get new stuff that often.
Jackie Brown has a literal needle drop when Jackie plays Didn't I Blow Your Mind This Time by the Delphonics for Max. Tarantino doesn't just use the song to underscore this heartwarming romantic scene. It becomes the pivotal point of the dialogue as Jackie and Max bond over their love of the music itself.
This is pretty.
Mm-hmm.
Who is this?
The Delphonics.
Nice.
Jackie and Max's attraction to each other is the subtext of their shared interest in the Delphonics. This needle drop is a key turning point in Tarantino's greatest love story. Lawrence Fishburne famously turned down the role of Jules in Pulp Fiction because he felt that the film glamorized heroin use. And that is true to an extent. This scene makes heroin use look really fun. But whether you agree with the ethics of glamorizing heroin, you can't deny that as long as that's what Tarantino was doing, he picked the perfect song to capture the allure of a euphoric high. The use of Bullwinkle Part 2 makes you feel the way Vincent feels when he shoots up. Throughout its entire runtime, Death Proof refuses to apologize for being a schlocky exploitation movie. In the first act, there's an extended lap dance sequence. Obviously, the main attraction in this scene is the sexy dancing, but it also has a banging soundtrack thanks to the Coasters' doo-wop debut single Down in Mexico. The opening scene of Django Unchained introduces Tarantino's Django to the sounds of Rocky Roberts and Louis Bacalov's iconic theme from Sergio Corbucci's original Django film. Just like in the original, this song elevates the title character to folk hero status and prepares the audience to watch a blood-soaked legend unfold. When Butch arms himself with a samurai sword and returns to the pawn shop basement to save Marcellus in Pulp Fiction, Comanche by the Revels matches the chaotic energy of the situation. And it also captures Butch's heroism and bravado and the satisfaction of his revenge. When the Manson murderers head up Cielo Drive, knives in hand, before the climactic massacre of Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, 12:30 gives you a second to reflect on the real-life tragedy that happened on this night in 1969. Then Vanilla Fudge's tortured, psychedelic rendition of You Keep Me Hangin' On by the Supremes sets up Tarantino's gonzo alternate version of how that evening plays out. Much like Stuck in the Middle with You, Coconut by Harry Nilsson creates a really powerful juxtaposition on the soundtrack of Reservoir Dogs. In this case, a goofy novelty song completely deflates the tension and brings you back down to earth after the really intense, breathtaking final scene. Coconut plays into the notion of how trivial the actual diamond heist seems in light of what happened afterwards.
Thanks for watching, guys. I hope you liked the video. Remember to like and subscribe and click on the little bell. And also seize the day and call your mom and be kind to yourself.